So this is a, I'm Bjorn Peterson. I'm one of the assistant medical directors for Regents Hospital EMS. We provide medical direction for most of the EMS agencies in the East Metro, St. Paul, and into Western Wisconsin. This is a topic that's kind of fun for me. I'm headed out this evening to go up to Alexandria for the Minnesota Medical Directors Retreat. We do this every year with all of the EMS medical directors across the state. And this is going to be one of the topics that we're going to talk about this weekend. So this is kind of a hot topic in EMS right now. And I just want to focus on a couple things here. We only have about 20 minutes. Things that you should be aware of from the hospital side to think about with spinal immobilization. So this picture, this is just a shot in the dark. Does anybody know what this picture is? James Dean, I heard it. Who said that? Well done. James Dean was an iconic American actor in the 50s. This was September 30th, 1955. He died in a car accident in the Central Valley of California. He died of massive internal injuries and a broken neck, was the final autopsy report. These people that have the stretcher there are not trained medical responders. This was well before we had any organized EMS structure in the country. So they literally just took him out of the car and threw him on a stretcher and drove him 25 miles to the nearest hospital. He was alive at the time of extrication, but died by the time he got to the hospital. So we can only speculate what his actual cause of death was, but he did have a broken neck. And I can guarantee you he did not receive any sort of standard spinal immobilization like we would think of today. So spinal injuries, there's about 200 to 300,000 people in the U.S. living with spinal injuries today. Every year there's an additional 12 to 13,000 people that develop a spinal cord injury. The cost of spinal cord injuries, the annual cost, medical cost for somebody with a spinal cord injury is anywhere from $30,000 to $50,000. And the lifetime cost can reach up to in the millions, $3 million, $4 million, depending on the complications. And obviously the life expectancy is reduced. Christopher Reeves is a great example of that. The other side of it is that there's a whole marketing, there's a whole sales culture around some of these medical devices. Each one of these backboards, the standard backboard, the yellow one there in the middle, is about $250 to $300. Some of these other devices become more expensive, but there's a whole host of immobilization devices that can be used to immobilize the spine after trauma. And what we've done in EMS over the last 30 years is make spinal immobilization the standard treatment for trauma patients. We base it on a mechanism of injury, so any suspicion for a spinal injury, high-speed motor vehicle crash, fall down more than three stairs or greater than the patient's height, a lot of these are very subjective determinations. The default is to immobilize the patient with full, cervical, thoracic, lumbar, long spine board and strap him down. Like this cartoon says, it's just a smash finger, but it was a high-risk mechanism apparently, so he got his full spinal mobilization. Here's the problem. The spine has four natural curves to it, and the backboard does not. So those two things anatomically don't fit together. When was the last time any of you working in an ER received a patient who had the voids appropriately padded underneath the patient on top of the long backboard? Anybody? When was the last time you received a patient in the ER who had a completely flat spine who anatomically fit with the long spine board? Never. So there's a problem here. This is not a neutral immobilization device. We are creating an unnatural anatomy by strapping somebody down to one of these devices. I borrowed this hat from Joel Holger to take a quick picture. Those of you who know Joel, he's our EBM guy at Regions, a pretty hardcore research person. And this is really how you have to apply that. So you can be very dogmatic about research, but the true EBM triad, evidence-based medicine triad, you take that evidence and you apply it to your experience and also what the patients value and expect from you. And if we can find that happy medium right in the middle where all of those intersect, that's truly where we're practicing evidence-based medicine. But most of us, I would say, this is kind of where the weight falls more often than not, our individual anecdotal experience, and then what the patients are expecting from us. So let's review a little bit of the evidence, pros and cons, for spinal immobilization. Does it work? Does it hurt? What's really out there? We'll start with the pro evidence. This is the Agency for Healthcare Research and Quality website. It's a division of the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services. A lot of acronyms here, National Guideline Clearinghouse. They basically stockpile a lot of clinical guidelines that we can use that are evidence-based for our medical practice. This one specifically is for pre-hospital cervical spine immobilization after trauma, published in 2013. What they found, it's not supported by class 1 or 2 medical evidence. When you get down to class 3 evidence, you're talking about potential for harm. So there's really no evidentiary support for spinal mobilization. But they go on to say this is an effective, time-tested practice based on anatomic and mechanical considerations, blah, 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 blah. So they're basically saying it works, but there's no evidence to support it. So I don't know how strong of a statement you can actually make of that. Cochrane summaries. Cochrane does these systematic reviews, so that's another good source for what is the summary of the evidence tell us. And this was specifically from 2009 for spinal immobilization for trauma patients. What they found is there are no randomized trials to look at the different methods of spinal mobilization. And there's actually some evidence that patients who are conscious, because of the discomfort, they might actually try to reposition themselves, which might make the movement a little bit worse. I think a great example of that was Amy Murphy in that video that we watched right before the break. In that helicopter, you saw that her scope of vision moving all over the helicopter, and yet she was in a cervical collar immobilized to a long backboard. She was conscious and alert and repositioning herself to try to see what was going on around her. So it's actually a myth of true spinal immobilization. For awake patients, we just can't completely immobilize the spine like we hope to. This was a study in 1998. It was a retrospective study looking at a group of patients in Malaysia and a group of patients in New Mexico. It was a case control, so they were looking at specifically patients with spinal injuries and then looking back to see who was immobilized and who wasn't, and did immobilization, was that related at all to their disability from these neurologic injuries? All of the Malaysian patients were not immobilized. They were just loaded onto a stretcher and taken to a hospital. They estimated that these hospitals were similar with regards to the physician training and the resources available. And what they found is that there was less neurologic disability in the unimmobilized Malaysian group compared to the immobilized group from New Mexico. And disability was defined by some independent physicians just reviewing the charts and looking at their ongoing physical deficits. So they're saying that this immobilization in an out-of-hospital setting has little or no effect on neurologic outcome in patients with blunt spinal injuries, blunt being the key word there. That's the evidence I could find for spinal mobilization. That's not great. So let's look at the other side. Pain. There was I'm going to quote several studies here. Most of these were in the mid-90s. 21 healthy volunteers without any prior back or neck problems were strapped to a long spine board with standard techniques for an hour, which is pretty typical if you think about from on scene into the hospital, the initial evaluation before you get rolled off of the backboard. Everybody had some immediate complaint of pain at some level along their backside where they were positioned on the board. 100% of those patients did. What if we add some padding to that board? Is that going to reduce the risk of pain? So this was 39 healthy volunteers. The black bar represents unpadded long backboards. The white bar represents padded backboards. The lower graph shows you the incidence of pain complaints immediately after taking them off of the backboard. And the upper right graph shows you the pain complaints 24 hours later. So even if we add padding to these backboards, there are still a significant number of people that are going to have pain at some level between the head and the sacrum, up to 24 hours after the original injury. What that means for us is we're going to image those people. If they have pain, if they have midline cervical tenderness, lumbar tenderness, which was the most common complaint, and they're in some sort of a high-risk mechanism of injury, we're probably going to get some form of imaging on those patients. Is that okay? Maybe, but maybe not. That's a lot of expense. There's an estimate. This is an old estimate from about 15 years ago. Close to $200 million a year is spent on imaging for spinal injuries after trauma. Maybe we can reduce that, but that's a significant expense on society to evaluate some of these injuries, let alone some of the radiation risks and other things that go along with that. Respiratory immobilization. So this was, again, mid-90s, a study of spinal mobilization effects on the healthy non-smoking man was the title of this study. I love the titles that they come up with. What did they find? If you strap somebody down to either a KED device, which is the upper graph there, which is kind of this green half-board thing that we use to initially strap people down, versus the long spinal board, which is the standard spinal board on the bottom there, there's a 15 to 20% reduction in pulmonary function once you put somebody on a spinal board. And these are healthy, non-smoking patients. Now let's take that to the other extreme, the non-healthy smoking patient or the elderly patient with COPD or some other underlying lung problem. They're not going to be able to breathe very well. So we're reducing their pulmonary function by 20% by putting them on a spine board. You know, in healthy patients, maybe not a big deal, but somebody with a pneumothorax or some other issue that prevents them from breathing, rib fractures, they could have a pretty difficult time moving air in and out. Another study showed a 25% reduction in mouth opening when the cervical collar was applied, which could inhibit your ability to effectively manage the airway. Another reason to take the collar off, or at least the front of the collar off, when you're managing a patient's airway. And it's airway issues are a significant cause of mortality in trauma patients too, so that's very important. Another issue here is the application of the collar itself. Two studies, one showed a mean increase in the ICP pressures of 4.5 millimeters of mercury or centimeters, I think it's centimeters of water is how we measure it. And when we're talking about 20 kind of being the cutoff for intervention or concern, that's a significant change, 4.5 centimeters. Just by applying the cervical collar without changing anything else about the patient's position. They think this is due to the occlusion of venous outflow from the head. That was also quantified with ultrasounds looking at the cross-section of the internal jugular vein, which increased significantly when you apply a cervical collar. Now, this was a study that really kind of prompted my desire to give this presentation today. This was given at the National Association of EMS Physicians annual meeting in 2013 down in Florida. This is a group out of Ireland. This is a proof of concept study. So it didn't reach statistical significance. It wasn't lots of patients. They put these dots on a healthy volunteer in the upper left corner there. And put him in a mock-up of a car that had crashed inside of their fire station and set up a whole bunch of infrared cameras around him to get a 3D modeling of the vectors of movement of his neck in all three planes. And then they attempted 8 different methods of extricating him from the vehicle, and then they measured the amount of actual degrees of movement in any vector of his neck. This is a great idea to really show us what we're doing when we're extricating these patients from vehicles. So the standard would be if the car's facing this way and I'm the driver, would be to either put a KED device or a half board, a short board on him, and then slide him onto a long board and take him out the driver's door, or spin him and take him out the passenger's door, or even better yet, either lift him straight up out of the car or straight back through the back seat. And then the 9th way they did this was just by asking him to open the door and under verbal guidance step out of the vehicle and sit down on the stretcher and lay back. You probably can guess where I'm going with this. These are their results. The bottom chart shows the absolute movement in any of degrees in any vector of this healthy patient with the 9 different methods of extrication. One of them clearly stands out. It's number 1 there. There's only about 6.5 degrees of movement in all 3 vectors. And that was fourfold less than number 4, significantly less than all the others. And guess which method was number 1? It was the control. That was asking the guy to step out of the car and lay down on the cot himself. So proof of concept, this is by no means a reason to change practice, but what it suggests is that somebody who's awake and alert probably does a better job of self-splinting their own potential spinal injuries than we do with some of these devices that we're applying to people. What I find most interesting, I would have thought that the KED device, number 4 there, in line, meaning you put the KED device on and then take the patient straight out of the back, so you're not doing any spinning or sliding at all, that actually had the most movement in any vector. So this is completely counterintuitive to what we normally would think about in EMS. Another risk is the risk of aspiration. You try to roll these patients on the board. What we know is we're not completely immobilizing them, so rolling them up on their side is probably not safe at all, even if they're on a board. If they start to vomit, it does take a few seconds to unbuckle everything from the stretcher and get that board tipped up, so we're really not catching it in time. So the Norwegians are doing something goofy, and for unresponsive trauma patients, they're pioneering this lateral trauma position where this is literally how they place their patients if they're unresponsive and have suffered any trauma. However, a review of this shows that basically educational efficacy and local implementation have gone ahead of medical science. There's absolutely no evidence to support this position at all. It's something you might hear about. It's not really being used in the U.S. at this point. So we don't really know. There's really no good way to do this. This is kind of the summary here. And I just want to also throw a disclaimer. I'm not anti-long spine boards. I'm here to challenge a little bit and just to kind of throw out this topic for discussion. I'm not suggesting that we completely do away with them. There are a couple large EMS agencies across the country that are trying to get rid of these boards and use them only as extrication devices and get the patient off of them as quickly as possible. But what we're seeing, if we look at this evidence really, is that there is evidence of harm by placing somebody on a long backboard and no evidence or very minimal evidence of any sort of benefit in true spinal immobilization with a long backboard. So now we're back to this National Guideline Clearinghouse. There is no class 1 or 2 medical evidence to support immobilization of the cervical spine after trauma. So it's a time-tested practice. Basically what they're saying is this is the way we've always done it, and so it must work, therefore it must work, even though there's really no evidence to support it. I don't know how strong that is for me. Now applying that back to this EBM triad, we don't have any external evidence to support this practice. So what we're going on now is our experience and our patients' values and expectations in the absence of any valid, legitimate science to support this practice. This has all culminated in about a decade of discussions, and it's been discussed before that as well, but the NAEMSP, which is an organization I am a part of, and they partnered with the American College of Surgeons Committee on Trauma, which is the main ACS group that helps oversee some of the trauma centers. And they came together and made this position statement. I just pulled out some of the highlighted points. Basically, they're saying we need to be judicious about backboard use and limit its use to appropriate patients. Not everybody needs to be put on a backboard. Whether or not a backboard is used, you can still maintain spinal precautions by securing a patient to a stretcher. What do we do when they're in the hospital? We roll them off the board and we leave them flat on their back on the stretcher. We don't put a slider board under them. We don't leave them on the hard board. We get them off the board as quickly as we can. And that's the bottom point there. We're trying to reduce the risk of pressure sores and ongoing pain from these boards. You can still maintain spinal precautions without a spine board, and that is the key. So anybody that's walking at the scene, we used to do these standing takedowns with the backboard where you get up behind them with the backboard and slowly lay them down. We've removed that from our EMS guidelines. There's absolutely no reason to do that. Just ask the patient to sit down on the cot. Put a collar on them if you're concerned about a neck injury, but just ask them to sit down and lay back. That's just as good as doing the standing takedown and probably better. Also, if you're doing any interfacility transfers of trauma patients, you should try to get them off the trauma board before you transfer them. You can still keep them in spinal precautions. Unless there's some goofy extenuating circumstance, you should really try to get them off of that board before you place them in an ambulance or a helicopter for a long-range, long-distance transfer. But again, the key is they are still in spinal precautions. You're just not rigidly immobilizing them to a long backboard. So what have we done with this information at Regions EMS? This is specifically a pre-hospital issue that I'm talking about here. This is our new EMS guideline from 2014. Basically, we've applied a modified version of the Nexus criteria. We added back in the high-risk mechanism of injury. I guess we're just still holding on to that time-tested dogma. But we're giving our providers, our paramedics and our EMTs, an opportunity for the extremely low-risk patients to not place them in a long spine board. And you can still maintain spinal precautions. You can still put a cervical collar on them, but not everybody needs a long spine board. And then the bigger question, since you're all here, what will you do? And the key that I want to get across to you is engage your providers, your pre-hospital providers. Don't judge them, don't question them necessarily if they come in with a patient who's not on a backboard. Feel free to have a dialogue with them about it, but there may be a good reason why they weren't placed on a long backboard, and that's not necessarily the right thing to do for all trauma patients. So this is the kind of a discussion. I think we need to change the hospital culture. We need to change the pre-hospital culture, and we need to figure out what is the right way to deal with these blunt trauma patients, the right way to immobilize their spine. Thank you very much.